We welcome our friends and visitors from far away, perhaps, who are watching us on their screens through the day today or through the week. Welcome to the Feast of the Epiphany at St John the Baptist at Lambton. We're glad you're here with us, aren't we, everyone?
Yeah.
Yes, they're glad you're here. Let's begin by singing listening to Paul and Noreen sing for us, "Hail to the Lord's Anointed." Today from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 2, it's verse 11. The Magi saw the child with Mary his mother, and they knelt down and worshipped him. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ, the Son of God, has been revealed as a light to the nations. Let us then bring our darkness to his light, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you, set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And now the hymn of praise, the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Eternal God, who by a star led Magi to the worship of your Son, guide the nations of the earth by your light, that the whole world may see your glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Thank you, Des, for bringing to us the first reading from the prophet Isaiah.
Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1 to 6. Excuse me, the fogging up. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. Excuse me, these glasses. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples. But the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Nothing will come to your light. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look about you. All assemble and come to you. Your sons come from afar, and your daughters are carried on the arm. Then you will look and be radiant. Your heart will throb and swell with joy. The wealth on the seas will be brought to you. To you the riches of the nations will come. Herds of camels will cover your land, young camels of Midian and Ephah, and all from Sheba will come, bearing gold and incense and proclaiming the praise of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Psalm this morning is 72, verses 1 to 7 and 10 to 14. Give the king your judgment, O God,
and your righteousness to the son of a king,
that he may judge your people rightly,
and the poor of the land with equity.
Let the mountains be laden with peace because of his righteousness,
and the hills also with prosperity for his people.
May he give justice to the poor among the people,
needy
and crush the oppressor. May he live while the sun endures,
and while the moon gives light throughout all nations.
May he come down like rain upon the new mown fields,
and the showers that water the earth.
In his time shall righteousness flourish,
and abundance of peace till the moon shall be no more.
The kings of Tarshish and of the isles shall bring tribute.
The kings of
Sheba and Seba shall offer gifts. All kings shall fall down before him,
and all nations
do him service. He will deliver the needy when they cry,
and the poor that have no helper.
He will pity the helpless and the needy,
and save
the lives of the poor. He will redeem them from oppression and violence. Their blood shall be precious in his sight.
Reading from Ephesians 3, 1-12. This is the reason that I, Paul, am a prisoner for Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles. For surely you have already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I wrote above in a few words, a reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. In former generations, this mystery was not made known to humankind, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace and was given me by the working of power. And although I am very the least of the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of the boundless riches of Christ and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church, the wisdom of God in its rich variety might be known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our gospel hymn, We Three Kings of Orient Are.
We three kings of Orient Are, bearing gifts we travel. Mountain, moor, and mountain, following yonder star. Oh, star of wonder, star of night, star with royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us to the perfect light. Glorious now, behold him arise, sacrificed, heaven sing out alleluia, heaven the earth replies. Oh, star of wonder, star of night, star with royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us to the perfect light.
Christ, according to Matthew chapter 2, beginning at the first verse. Glory to you, Lord Jesus. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising, and we have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time that the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I also may go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, take our minds and think through them. Take our lips and speak through them. Then take our hearts and set them on fire. For Jesus' sake we pray. Amen. We three kings of Orient are bearing gifts. We travel so far, field and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star. Oh, star of wonder, star of night, star of royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us to the perfect light. Words we know so well, inspired by Matthew, who tells the story of the Gentile magi, who are the ones to see the signs and learn from the prophecies where the new king is to be born, and they set out from far away to find him. The Jewish leaders of Israel, despite knowing what the scriptures said, didn't seem interested in coming to find out what it was all about. Matthew paints a picture in such a way that has captured the imaginations of generations of people through the years. We read the story of the exotic magi every year on the Feast of the Epiphany, which is actually the 6th of January, but I've moved it forward so we can celebrate it in church together today. Orthodox Christians will gather in their churches on the 6th of January to celebrate the Feast of the Epiphany because it's their Christmas Day, the day for them when the Magi represent the great body of people beyond Judaism who have come to faith. We'll probably see on the evening news on Wednesday footage of the celebrations. Have you seen them before? Yes, they're often on the news on that night. The symbolism of Matthew's story of the star may be based on an image in the book of Numbers where a Gentile magus or prophet or a wise man refers to the coming of a future king when he writes, "I see him but not now, I behold him but not near. A star shall come forth out of Jacob and a scepter shall rise out of Israel." In chapter 1 of his gospel, Matthew has traced Jesus' ancestry, his Jewish ancestry, and has described Jesus' identity as Saviour, right at the beginning of the gospel, with references to the scriptures. But in this most Jewish of all the four gospels, Jesus' birth is revealed through the visit of the Gentile Magi in chapter 2. And then, at the gospel's conclusion, Jesus' final command to his disciples is to go out into the world, tell everyone, Gentiles, everyone, to bring them into the life of God. I think it's amazing that Matthew, writing in the late 70s or 80s of that first century, has already grasped so clearly that Jesus is Saviour of the world, Jew and Gentile. And so the way his whole gospel is written, from the birth story onward, is to emphasise for his mostly Jewish Christian readers or hearers how crucial it is that they understand and accept this shocking for them epiphany or revelation of God, a truth Matthew himself has come to realise with such clarity that God's purposes for his Messiah, his promised Messiah, go far beyond what they as Jews had ever understood. The Saviour, Jesus, our Lord, is for the whole world, not just for them. The Gentile Magi, then, are used by Matthew right at the beginning of his gospel to show us this, an exotic-sounding word, Magi, giving rise to our word magic, but it's really best left untranslated because it contains elements of priest, prophet, astronomer, astrologer, wise man, king. These men were maybe part of the Persian educated class and people who believed that extraordinary astrological signs in the sky could accompany the birth of a new ruler. So convinced of this were these Magi that they undertook their long and arduous journey, their intense curiosity, perhaps most of all, the driving force for them to venture forth to find the new king who they believed would be the end of all searching. They set out, leaving all that was familiar, not knowing where they were going, off into the unknown. Pretty brave. Carrying their three precious gifts, which may mean there were three of them, but not necessarily. We're not told how many magi there were. Yes, there were three gifts, but maybe there were 33 or 2 or 10. Doesn't matter, and we don't know. But in his story, as well as these exotic strangers seeking the new king, Matthew gives us the scribes and the priests, the religious wise men, who probably didn't know much about the sun and the stars and the skies, but they have their scriptures in which all the information needed to find where the new king is to be born are there, but they're not interested. But the wise men are. So when the star stops over Jerusalem and they ask where the king is and find this new king is not there, they show how really wise they are by not being too proud to ask questions of those who do know and to learn from them, the scribes. And so off they go to Bethlehem, where they find the baby Jesus, fall down and worship him, overwhelmed with joy. Matthew tells us they were going home by another road, perhaps changed forever by that encounter. As I would suggest, all people down through the years after their encounter with Jesus are changed, transformed, the beginning of a new life for each one of us when we encounter Jesus. These Magi, then, are like all of us who make our journey to God. Like them, you and I may have taken a rather convoluted route through our lives to calling ourselves Christian and being here today. Maybe your road in your Christian life has been dead smooth like this, but I would guess I'm not unusual in having a rather zigzag way to where I am today. Few of us, I would imagine, have had spiritual lives where the path has been in a nice, straight spiritual line. Mine certainly hasn't. Most of you, I would think, have gone off in some weird or strange direction for a while till God has brought you back, found you, and perhaps in the most amazing of ways, set you on the path towards him again. Is that true for you? I know it is for me, and I'm eternally grateful for the people and events that God has used to bring me back to him. Like us, those wise men would have travelled in darkness sometimes. Remember, the story does not say the star stayed with them, guiding them all the way. It appeared at his birth and again over Jerusalem, but where was it the rest of the time? We're not told. So those Magi surely must have been a bit lost at times, not knowing if they were going the right way, even anxious, confused and afraid, doubting the wisdom of the whole venture that they're embarking on. But it was their curiosity at least, but maybe also their yearning, their longing, that helped them to persevere. And they kept going, and they did. And what an inspiration they are to us. Here at Lambton, in the 12 months since Marie has retired, you've had several locum priests. Your church has closed and opened again. You've started recording your service for those who are at home. You have taken to wearing masks, and you have been so amazingly good at doing that. We've been not singing, then we've been allowed to sing, and now we're not singing again. Oh, but you've hung in there. Despite anxieties and confusion, look at what you've achieved, what you've done. You've supported and encouraged each other when things are tough, and surely the Magi did that too. We don't do discipleship alone. We're meant to be here for each other, helping, supporting, encouraging each other. And in what I've seen, you're doing that really well. But again, when I think of the Magi, I wonder if they might also help us not to be judgmental of others whose spiritual journeys might seem strange. You may know people, as I do, whose spiritual searching takes them off in all sorts of strange directions. I think that really all people carry a deep yearning for God's love that's underneath all the other yearnings and longings in our lives, that longing for connection to know the love of God. Whether these people recognise that in their own search for meaning in their lives or not, and maybe their seeking sees them exploring even dangerous ideas. But God may well draw some of them whose hearts and ears and minds are open towards him. But it might be through your playgroup or coming to the door unexpectedly here on a Sunday, halfway through the service even. But they've come. So we need to always be ready with that welcoming, non-judgmental smile, saying, come in, join us, find what we've got. We want to share it with you. We need to offer compassion and acceptance to all who come through those doors, never judgmental of them. Now, I feel very strongly about this because I was one of those seekers many years ago. We who have gathered here today know that we're here because we're wanting to find out more about God's love for us, aren't we? And we want to learn and grow in our knowledge of him. And we know that we travel together in faith and hope and love. Yes, we do, don't we? And in that, we can rejoice that we can all learn something of God from each other. The wise men, although already wise, were willing to learn, eager to grow, and so should we be too. They found the answer to the end of their search in the scriptures, and so can we. I read a little card somewhere that said, wise people in every generation seek Jesus. And I hope that's you and me. Perhaps a good New Year's resolution might be to know our Bibles better, to use 2021 to explore the scriptures more, that your faith might be nourished and you might grow. If you were to do that, what would you be like 12 months from now, with your faith having grown by this time next year, I wonder? The Lord be with you. Would you now stand with me as we... Oh, no, you don't stand with me, you sit. You sit. It's just automatic, isn't it? So please remain seated as we affirm the faith of our church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son. Christ.
Loving God, you have promised that you will hear us when we ask in faith. Receive these prayers we offer. God of wisdom, we thank you for the Magi and for the people of wisdom in every age. Inspired by their humility, open-mindedness, curiosity and courage, may we, like them, persevere in our searching for and finding you. We pray for your wisdom to rule in the hearts of the leaders of all the nations of the world. May your Holy Spirit inspire them to continue always to wisely seek justice and peace within their borders and with all the countries of our world. We ask for wisdom for those working to develop vaccines that will control coronavirus that the ravages of the disease is bringing everywhere in our world, especially amongst the poorest and most vulnerable, will cease. God of love, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of our journey, the Magi remind us this morning that they did not travel alone to find you. Thank you for the companions in our church with whom we are pilgrims towards the promised land of your kingdom. We give thanks for the friendships in the church with which you bless us, those with whom we share faith, love, and encouragement in our faith. We pray for them by your name in our hearts right now. We ask you now to bless with your wisdom those who lead and guide our church through both joyful and challenging times. We thank you for Bishop Peter, for Bishop Sonia and Bishop Charlie and Archdeacon Arthur. We pray for Reverend Sally and for all those who, with her, are looking after our parish at the moment. We ask you to bless Reverend Kate and her family as they prepare to come here to St John the Baptist at the beginning of March. Companion God, in your mercy. God of community, we pray for the communities in which we live, work and play. Remembering particularly in this holiday season, the police and paramedics, doctors and nurses who are at the front line in dealing with accidents on the road, domestic violence and the coronavirus. We thank you for them and for their dedication. Keep them safe, we pray. Give them your wisdom and all they need to protect our communities, especially the most vulnerable. God of love, in your mercy. Amen. God of healing, we bring to you this morning those who are suffering in any way, in body, mind, soul, or spirit. We know that this time of year is a time of great loneliness and anguish for many people. Many of us know people who are sick or grieving, or in pain or great distress right now. As we think of them and picture them before us, we ask your healing love for them, and not just for them, but for all others like them, unknown to us, who may have no one to pray for them. God of compassion, in your mercy. God of eternal wisdom, we praise you for the Magi and all people of wisdom and courage who have gone before us into your kingdom. We remember today with thanksgiving your faithful servant, Peg Coughlin. After our pilgrimage through this earthly life, may we come one day to be with her at the feast you have prepared for all who have searched for you, where we will all see you face to face and be with you forever. Wise and loving God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Jesus said, "Come to me, all who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Let us pray. We do not presume our table, merciful Lord,
trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather our crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so that with the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood,
brothers and sisters, we are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. For Anglicans who don't like to wave their arms around much, we do pretty well at the greeting of the feast, don't we? Thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine, And we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us then proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore we do, as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. And looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body.
We all share in one bread.
Jesus, Lamb of God,
have mercy on us.
Jesus, redeemer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us your peace. Come, my sisters and brothers, or stay where you are. Let us receive the body and blood of Christ, food, nourishment for our journey.
rich and the haughty, gather us in the proud and the strong. Give us a heart so weak and so lonely, give us the courage and enter the song. Here we will take the wine and the water, here we will take the bread of your birth. Here you shall call your sons and your daughters, call us on you to be salt of the earth.
Come to